And then during the class, I think one good idea is you can bring your laptop. Because in the class, we can also do the coding in the class. Of course, it is not required, but if you have a laptop, then you can enjoy this class more. And then we will learn Taylor series expansion, but before that, I have a homework. Homework one, post your research question at the bulletin board of our class before next Wednesday class starts. You have to convince the reader that your research question is original, interesting, and important. About our bulletin board, this is Hanyang portal, and then my home, and then you can click our class, fixed income securities, and then there is a bulletin board. You can please post your homework, copy and paste your homework here, research question, and argue why it is interesting and why it is original. So it means that everyone can read each other's research question, right? So I think that is fair. Otherwise, when at the end of the semester, when I assign grade, maybe you are not so happy with your grade, and maybe you can ask me what's the basis of my terrible grade or something like that. And therefore, I wanna keep everything open for this class. By the way, it is sometimes possible that two students have exactly the same research idea. That is always possible. In that case, it is first come, first served. Whoever posts his whole research idea first, he has priority. Okay? So if two students have exactly the same research idea, latecomer should change his or her research idea. Okay? Any question? Yes.
Is it only a suggestion? Is it only a suggestion, or is it? Do we have to find the tweet?
Suggestion? Yeah, you have to find your own research question. You mean what suggestion?
I mean, like, if we kind of post our research question, then do we have to stick to it until the end of the semester?
Of course, yeah. No, you don't have to. I will review your research question, and then if I think that your research idea is terrible, I will recommend you to change it. Yeah. But the thing is that you have to change you have to find your research idea early on, and it is better to stick to it throughout the semester. Right? Suppose you change your research question in the middle of the semester, that is fine, but then you have less amount of time to write your term paper. Then you are likely to fail this class as well. So please find your research question early, as early as possible, and start working on it as early as possible. That's the best way to gain the good grade. You see? Yeah. It's obvious, right? Any other question? Yes, bond or interest rate, or fixed income derivatives, anything. I will not give you any more hint. Any other question? And then that's the homework one, due next Wednesday. Another homework is write R code for Taylor series approximation for sine x by next Wednesday class. What is Taylor series approximation? I'll teach you right now. And print out your code and solution and submit it at the beginning of the Wednesday class. You need to show how approximation error decreases, the order of approximation decreases. And homework 3. Implement bootstrapping described in the example in the section 2.4.2, I think, in the book. Where is it? This one. Section 2.2, there is an example. So basically, you implement, you solve 2.4.2 with R. Okay. By the way, did you happen to have a chance to go over the R online lecture? Yes. Oh, actually, you have to use R. Sorry. Using R. Yes, so, yeah. Yeah, there is an example in section 2.4.2.
So we just use the
yes. Solve that example with R. It'll be fun. About the today's topic, we have so much things to do. I don't think we, first, about this one. This is one I already taught this one last week, right? Last week. So Z thing, that T, big T, small T. Okay. This is the value of contracts that promise pay $1 at this time, evaluated at this time, small time, small T, right? So in this textbook, bond means zero coupon bond means that the principal amount is $100. Therefore, this definition of this discount factor, it is the value of the contract that pays $1 at the maturity. Therefore, we want to calculate the value of contract that pays $100 at the maturity. Then we simply multiply 100. It is per dollar, 100, so it is zero coupon bond price. Usually also we say this is simply zero coupon bond price, but it is just a matter of normalization. Normalization, so it is how we can calculate zero coupon bond price with the principal value is $100, 100 discounted today. Okay, this is just a one-time payoff, okay, it is zero coupon bond price. How about bonds with a lot of coupon? Then it is easy. We can decompose usually coupon paying bond, series of zero coupon bond, and calculate value of series of zero coupon bond and summing up, right? Therefore, if in this textbook, when you say coupon bond, take pay coupon every 6 months, right? That's why we have to coupon rate C. So per $100, they pay C amount of coupon. Therefore, they are the cash flow every 6 months we receive this one, and at the end we receive last coupon, half of C multiplied by 100, and then we receive principal amount. So we can calculate present value of everything by multiplying this discount or per dollar value of the contract, then we can calculate coupon bearing bond price. Of course, if we multiply this one, we can send 100 inside of this one. Simply, this is zero coupon bond price with principal amount 100. So this one becomes this one. Again, coupon bearing bond price is a series of zero coupon bond. Okay, is it clear? If it does not hold, we have arbitrage opportunity. We can simply buy undervalued part and selling overvalued part, and that's done. Any question? Am I too fast? 너무 빨라요? 안 빠르지? 이건 다 아는 거 아니야, 솔직히. 그렇지. 여러분이 이미 재무관리에서 배웠을 거라고 생각해서 빨리 하는 겁니다. If you have a question, you can ask in Korean. Okay. 질문 없죠? 확실히 아는 거지. 네, 넘어갑니다. 네. 이건 뭐 배웠을 테니까. 네. Now, I have to teach floating rate one, but let's cover that one at the next class. I don't want to forget. Floating rate, that's very important. But because you have to do your homework, I don't think I can cover this one. We are so behind the schedule. But because you have to do your homework, I have to teach you what is the Taylor series approximation. Have you ever heard about Taylor series approximation? If you took my 기초 투자론 class, then you must have. 오현주 학생 알겠네. 기초 투자론 들었으니까. No one heard of Taylor series approximation at all? How about our German friend? Did you? How about Dutch? Oh, okay. Even Europeans didn't learn. Taylor series approximation is important in finance, okay? So you have to know it. Taylor series approximation. The Taylor series. So this is the Taylor series approximation. So how can I explain this in easy? So suppose we have a very complicated strange function called fx, and then maybe we are interested in get approximation of that fx around point A. So this is basically so fx, okay, not exactly fx, but approximation of fx. So we have arbitrary function fx. So suppose we have let's delete this part. Suppose we have function fx, and then suppose fx looks like this, some weird function. Okay, and suppose there is a x equal a, and we want to approximate this fx around this area. Okay, not globally, around at the point of x a, and then Taylor series approximation is one way to approximate fx around a. Right, and then the thing is that, in particular, when we approximate fx, we approximate this fx with a function that we are familiar with. What kind of function are you familiar with? You are familiar with like linear function, right? X square function, something like this, right? So in Taylor series approximation, if we have a given fx, we want to approximate fx around A with constant, which is of course x0, x1, x square, something like that. So basically, we want to approximate fx with constant x, x square, x third square, x to the power of 3, to the power of 4, something like that. Because we are familiar with this kind of function. We know how they behave, what kind of shape they take, right? You know how, what is like fx equal x, what is like fx equals x shape, something like this. X square, something like this. You are familiar with it. So you approximate fx with that kind of familiar function. The idea is very simple. Let's do that. Let's do the approximation. Okay? Suppose suppose this is the A, x equal A, and then we want to approximate this one. First, we use the most familiar function, which is simply constant. Okay, constant. F like y equals c, some kind of constant. Okay, using so the function which take constant value is how does it shape? The shape is just the line, right? Simple line. So how we can approximate this function at this particular point, that's actually impossible, right? This constant is simply this one, line. How can I approximate this function with line? Impossible. But the best thing we can do is simply we can match at a particular point. That's the best thing we can do, right? So we can match. Okay. This is the maybe the best thing we can do. We want to move this line around and approximate this one, which is impossible. But if we set this one like this one, at least FA equal to, okay, FA equal to this particular value. So this is actually right, right? the best thing you can do. So this value is simply, right, simply FA, right? And then next, now we can, let's have one more degree of freedom. Now let's say, suppose we have linear function, right? Now we have a constant plus linear function. Then how linear function is, looks, linear function is simply line, right? Line. How can I approximate this one with line? Still that is not possible, but if you are careful, at least we can do something like this. At least we can do something like this, right? Right? That's the something we can do, right? Yeah. This is of course not perfect approximation, but with the line, that's the best thing we can do, right? Because first, at this particular point, because it matches exactly point FA. Second, if we draw line like this, at least at the very small interval, marginal change in fx is exactly same to the marginal change in this line. Right? So that's the best thing you can do. So what is the equation for this line? That is simple. Oops. That is simple. This is simply, okay. First, it starts from this value, so fa, okay, we keep this one, plus, right, f prime a x minus a, right? This equation is the formula for this line, right? When x is a, we have this part is zero, we have only fa part, so at A, at the point A, two functions, this function and this line, exactly matches as FA. In addition to that, because the marginal slope is the same, let's take derivative with respect to X at the point A. Then it is simply F prime X. And the value at this point is F prime A, right? And in this point, let's take derivative. If we take derivative, if we take derivative of this line, okay, we don't have this part anymore, and we have only this one, right? Therefore, the derivative of this line is exactly same to this one. So now, if we use the line, we can match the absolute level, and we can match the slope. Right? Actually, we can, now let's add one more degree of freedom. Now we can add the, we can bend the, okay? Now we can bend. Suppose we can bend this one. Then maybe what we can do is, suppose now we can use, so in this case we use constant, in this case we use linear function. Now suppose we can use now x square function. X square function looks like this or this, like this one, right? So if we match at this point, what we can do best is maybe some kind of line, this one. It is not good picture, or something like this, right? It should be like if we draw figure A, now it becomes more and more close. Now if we use a squared function, now around this area, now we have even better approximation. Then question, what is the formula for this one? Of course, because now we match left level, first derivative, and now we can match the second derivative. Therefore, the formula for this one is now FA plus F prime A x minus a now plus 2 f 2 prime a x minus a square, right? First, when x is a, this term, when x is a, we have this term and this term goes away. Okay, so we match absolute level. Second, if we take first derivative, this term goes away, this one in front of it, and if we plug x equal a, this term becomes zero, and we have f prime a. So we match the first derivative. For second derivative, if we take derivative with respect to x two times, this one goes away, this one goes away, then two, and then x, it goes away, so f prime a. Okay, so it actually matches second derivative as well. Okay, and if we now use x3, you can actually borrow. So if you keep doing that, you have equations like this. So up to this part is exact, because 2 factorial is 2, 1 factorial is 1. So this part is exactly same to this part. Okay, and we can keep doing that. This is a Taylor series approximation. And then, in general, this can be written like this one, right? Means nothing, right? Very easy. Any question? 질문 있어요? 한국어로 질문을 해. Any question? Did you learn this one? You are engineering department, so you learn this one, right? No? Yeah, you are, right, you are business student. Yes. So, in finance, Taylor series approximation is very popular. One application in bond pricing is duration and convexity. When in bond pricing, when you say duration, duration is this one, this part. When you say convexity, convexity is simply this part. Okay. So, actually, in duration convexity approximation, we just forget about this part. We use only of the second part. I will cover that later on. Any other question? 질문 있어요? 네. So homework is that in bond pricing we have used only up to second order, right? But suppose we can use third order, fourth order, something like that, maybe we can have a better and better approximation. Okay? If it is infinite approximation, it becomes very close. For the most function we know. Okay? Therefore, if we, as we increase the order of approximation, the error between the true value and this one will be narrowed down, become smaller and smaller. Okay? And that's the homework you have to show with R. By the way, when x is 0, when a is 0, when we are to approximate a function at the particular point 0 instead of general point a, it is called, it is also Taylor series approximation, but it is specially called Maclaurin approximation. Yeah, any question? Yeah, 질문 있어요, 또? 이 정도는 배웠어야 되는데. 질문 있나? 네? 하나도 이해를 못하겠어? 여기도 하나도 이해 못하겠나? 조금 어렵다. 숙제를 하면 다 이해할 거야. 아, 그리고 잘 이해가 잘 안 간다. 잘 안 가면 유튜브에 가서 강의를 들으면 됩니다. 내가 항상 하는 유튜브에다가 유튜브에서 테일러 시리즈 어프로시메이션 검색하면 한 100개는 강좌가 있을 거야. 그런 거 하나 들으면 돼요. 우리말로 된 것도 잘하면 있을지 몰라. 한번 찾아볼까? 어, if you want to more different lecture, Taylor 급수. Yeah, there is a Korean explanation. 대학 미적분학, Taylor 급수와 Maclaurin. That's perfect. Right, Taylor series and Maclaurin series. Give a 6-minute lecture, 12-minute lecture, 3-hour lecture. Well, you have a full menu for your choice. Right? What a wonderful world, right? So let's talk about your homework. So you have to write R code. So have anyone took online lecture for R? You did. How was it? Okay. How about other students? You didn't? Oh, you did. Okay. How was it? Was it fun? 그렇지. 하나도 안 어려워. 이제 중학생도 쓸 수 있게 이렇게 만들어 놓은 거예요, 사실. 전혀 어렵지 않습니다. 그래서, 이 is a confidential one. So bootstrapping method. This, by the way, this bootstrapping is different from this bootstrapping. So between this one, and then save, make a copy, R code, exercise for fixed income. And then for you, I'll connect this one to course web page. Okay. Sample R code and exercise. Insert link. Now, if you click this one, you can see the code. So let's do some practice. So, okay, sharp. In this case, when in R code, when I put sharp, then R code cannot read the particular line. So, yeah, if I, you can put sharp in front of the code, you can write down any crazy things next to it. Computer cannot understand it. So it is good for your memory. So in this case, I, in order not to forget it, for note-taking purpose, this is for fixed income class. Okay. These are R code is for fixed income security class. Okay. So I put sharp and write up because I want to keep track of this one. And the second line, remove list LS. This is the this line. It is my habit. Before I start writing a code, I always put this line because this removes all prior memory, and data. Okay, so it clean up the computer memory. So you can start from blank. It is set wind. It determines working directory. So when you generate an output or when you read the data, you can read data from this one. So in this case, it is dtemp. Dtemp is the folder. From this folder, I can read the data or I can send out the data, something like that. Okay. So let's do the Taylor series. Your homework is to do the Taylor series approximation with sin x. Right, sin x. So again, let's go to Taylor series approximation in Wikipedia. Let's find an example. Okay, the Maclaurin series. So again, Maclaurin series is Taylor series approximation at the point zero. So let's check the one. Let's check this one. This is the geometric series. So let's say. Okay, so let's try this one. Okay. I don't need this one anymore. So in R, you can actually define a function. So when you define a function like R function, you can always find the Google, check Google. And in Google, because R is open source and all the manual and all the information is there. So, okay, in the Google, you want to make your own user-defined function, and this is a way to user-defined function. Okay, my function, arrow, function, and argument, and return. Okay, done. Let's use this one. Okay, so you want to write, yeah. Bigger. Is it okay now? Is it better? Yeah. Our function, which is my function, okay? Name of my function is this one. My function is a function, and it has an argument x. And then, in this example, In this example, it is what? It is 1 over 1 minus x, right? I'll connect this one for you. So, bracket, and then inside of the bracket, you will write down the function. And then, return 1 minus x. Okay, let's use, let's say y equal, okay, 1 over 1 minus x. Okay, so this is the function I make. And then I want to return y. Okay, so I develop my own function. Let's try this one in R. Okay, I have to start R. I run R. Okay, so my function, and if I put minus 1, what should be the answer? 2? Yes. Right, easy, right? Is it cool? If I do 1, it is infinity, not well defined. If I put 0, it of course becomes 1. Right? So I defined, I just created my own function. Actually, you don't have to write it down because in the course webpage, again, I provide a link to the code. So it's fine. Next, okay, this is my function, and then I have to make, this is original function. Okay? This is original function. And next, as follows is Taylor series approximation at 0. Okay, so Maclaurin series. So let's check it. So in the Taylor series approximation, okay, of course you have to take derivative and then blah blah. So by the way, let's find this function is too boring. Actually, this is too boring. Let me find more interesting. Okay, log 1 minus x. I think this is better. No. 2, 3, 4. No, is there any? Oh, I think this is better. Ex. Okay, ex. I think this is better. Okay, Taylor series expectation approximation with say ex. This seems better. So, instead of this one, let me change it. Exp x. Okay? So for Taylor series approximation at the point of 0, this looks like, this Taylor series approximation looks like this. This is actually definition of exponential function, right? We learned this one already, right? So we can try this one. So this is simply, okay, my fun 2 is function x and then y equals now 1, okay, plus okay, 1 plus 1 factorial over 1 and 2 factorial over 2, something like this, right? So x plus, in case of R, I think factorial 3, factorial 4, okay, 12, that's 24, that's right. So over factorial 1, and then x square over factorial 2 plus x to the power of 3, and then factorial 3, right? And then return y, right? So it is an approximation of the third order, right? Third order. So I approximate this one. Okay. So I created two functions, and now my goal is to compare error, approximation of this in the two. Okay, so let's run this one together. on this one. So let's say my phone 0 is 1, and then my phone 2, 0, 1. Well, this is a perfect approximation. Actually, it is not surprising. So, and then let's check the approximation at the particular point 2. In this case, there is approximation error, right? Because it is, because it is deviation from zero. Even, I mean, in the most of the cases, even at the particular point zero, there is possibly, in this case, exact, but as this two is close to zero, we have better and better approximation, right? So, in this case, if we put like 0.5, then the approximation is very small because we are close to it. Okay? So what you have to do is, now approximation error is simply the difference between the two. Right? This is approximation error. What you have to show is that as we increase the order of the approximation, you have to show that this becomes 0 and 0, close to 0 and 0. And then in this case, we have, right, we have to basically, if we increase order, you have to keep adding it. In order to keep adding something, what you can do, you can use for sentence. It's a loop sentence. So, what you can do instead of this one is, right, for example, if n is 3, if we want to do third order approximation, then 4, I, how can, you can do the approximation, so, okay, in, okay, I, in, it starts from 0 to 3, 0 to 3, and then you have to do is, starting value, that's starting value 0. And then thing is that y equals y plus, now you have to adding this one, so x to the power of I divided by factorial I. Okay? So it starts from 0. When I is 1, then we add power of 0 and factorial 0 is 1, so this is exactly this one, right? And then if we go to this one again, okay, now we have to iterate this operation from 0 to 3, so when I equals 0, then this part is equal to this one, so when I equals 1, now we store previous value, which is this one, and we now add x to the power of 1 and factorial 1, so this, we are adding this part. When it increases 3, this one. So as we increase this number, we have better and better approximation, right? Let's say this is n. And so I can remove this part now. Actually, I can even put n over here. Okay. Here, n is the order of approximation. Okay, so let me try this one again. Okay, so again, my function 3 looks like this, and then my function 2, and then I want to approximate at point 3, and then if I make order of approximation like 5, 13, but if I make it like 10, it becomes 13. Why it is keep 13? 100. There is something wrong with this 3. Why it is n 3? Ah, sorry. Now n is now input variable. So, okay, let me do it again. So I found 2.5 is this one. And my phone 2.5. If I do the approximation of the degree of 3, 2, this difference. If I increase it to 10, now 11, it becomes closer and closer, right? 100, then it becomes very close, right? It is natural, right? Because it's the, by definition, of the Taylor series approximation. I increase the order. I keep adding the remaining term. So I have a better and better approximation. About this summation increases n to infinity, of course, I cannot add it up to infinity. So I have to add something like number n. So instead of this infinity, if I put capital N, this part is exactly this part in the loop sentence. This part. Okay, this part. So again, this is the function. Now I just create a new function, which is two arguments. First one is point at which I want to do the approximation. The second one is order of the approximation. Right? And this one is just I iterate this one from I to 0 to n. Right? Starting from 0 and I keep adding new terms in Taylor series approximation and I have it. Okay, so you need only up to this part and the other part you don't need it. So any question? Now, I think I can key, I already gave you a lot of hint. Now, instead of ex, now my function is ex, actually ex, I don't even have to create new function because there is already function ex. So what you have to do is instead of this my function, you can use your sin x, which is already there. So you don't have to create sin x function like this one. I think this is stupid. But in you have to write this part. In order to write this part, you have to take the derivative of sin x and then things like that. Right? What kind of function does it have if we take derivative of sin x with respect to the x? The cosine x, right? What if we take two times second derivative with respect to x, what we have? If we take derivative of sin x two times with x, then what we have? It is minus sin x. It is minus sin x. So if you take derivative of sin x four times, it is sin x. Right? So there is a like a pattern. So it is easy to write down this step of code. So your homework is that you can write Taylor series approximation for sin x and print out your code and show with graph or whatever how approximation decreases. You can print out your solution and code and submit your homework here by Wednesday class. Okay. And this is the part one. And to remind you, you have to write another code for bootstrapping part.